Welcome to the My Tech Tool Belt podcast. We're your hosts. I'm Shannon.
And I'm Brenda. And this is a podcast where we highlight educators who innovate, engage, and inspire through the use of technology. Thank you so much for joining us today for episode 32 of the My Tech Tool Belt podcast. Today, we have the opportunity to speak with Amanda Johnston from the San Diego area of California. Amanda shares with us her journey of accepting a principal position in July of a small and struggling Catholic K-8 school. She tells us of her wanting to continue with a promise to the students, their families, and her faculty with a mission to take the school in a blended learning direction. She has such great insights and real honesty about their journey so far, so we really hope you enjoy this episode. So, without further ado, our interview with Amanda Johnston.
Welcome, everyone. Today on the My Tech Tool Belt podcast, we are talking to Amanda Johnston, principal at St. Mary's School in Escondido. And we're going to be talking today about just Amanda's journey as a principal and integrating technology into her school. She's in the early stages of this, and just the decision-making process, the teacher support that she's got to experience, and just all kinds of fun stuff. So thanks for joining us, Amanda.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
So to kick us off, about you and your journey, and because you've been in education for a while, and how you became principal at St. Mary's, and kind of where your school is kind of situated as far as demographics and things like that. Just tell us a little bit about that.
So I started teaching 10 years ago in a Catholic school in San Francisco, and I've been in Catholic schools this whole time. I moved to San Diego area back in 2011 when I got married. And I ended up at St. Mary's School Escondido, where I was the third grade teacher. And then there, I've also served as a reading specialist. I took a year off after my son was born and came back into the third grade classroom. And then 3 years ago, I was asked to take over as principal, and I assumed that position. And I spent the first year really looking at the school and its needs and talking to a lot of parents and students and teachers and making decisions, working with people and trying to figure out how we could best serve the needs of our students. We have a very small school. At the time when I first started, we started the first day of school with 124 students. And so it was about serving the needs of the students with things like combo classes and things like that. And so that's really when that blended learning conversation came to be. And so with that, we needed technology. And so the research began, and started trying to network and collaborate with other people. And we formed partnerships with Loyola Marymount University's Ideal Institute. And they've kind of helped us along the way. In year three, we're up to about 155 students. And we serve a variety of students. I think we're about 60% Caucasian and about 40% Hispanic, and most of our families are working class. And so we try to keep our tuition as low as possible. And so we rely heavily upon donations from other people to be able to do these fun initiatives with our students.
So you've increased your enrollment, obviously, since you started as principal. And in the early stages, you were looking at blended learning. I think as I recall in a conversation, the previous principal had said, we're moving towards blended learning. And so there wasn't a lot of traction made on that initiative. And so you kind of came in and was like, okay, what is blended learning? We're going to do blended learning. Let's figure this out. And so you wanted to make good on that commitment.
Correct. It was never really laid out clearly. And that was really at no one's fault. We didn't necessarily have a strong understanding of what it was. And at the same time, while we were trying to communicate that message out to our parents, we were forced to combine classes. And so parents started to think that a combo class was the same thing as blended learning. And so actually, as my first year of principal, we stopped using the word altogether, because I had been doing my research and I liked the idea of blended learning, but I didn't want there to be confusion about what it meant. So we focused on what a combo class was, what a multiple age learning environment was. And then we were able to really set forth the vision. Think about it, plan it out, and communicate it in a way that we would have parent input as well as parent appreciation for the model. We wanted to give them time since we're doing something different. We wanted to bring them along with us as we made these decisions, as opposed to just be like, oh, by the way, this is what we're doing, you know? And so that's kind of how it came. So yeah, we really said we were doing blended learning. We weren't quite. There was a little bit of tech integration. The teachers were doing the best they could, but we just didn't have the technology to really be able to do it, or the support to allow the teachers to understand what it was and move forward. Everything was just research online and doing it as the teachers were trying to grapple with less students and how are we going to get money for things and are we going to be able to stay open? You know, those were these real conversations that we were having. And then you were asking them to do blended learning on top of that with lacking the technology and the support from, you know, professional development or different providers.
That's so... You've used a lot of the buzzwords that we use in education, and so you said you guys were doing tech integration, and that now you're moving towards blended learning. And so, can you just like help our listeners understand what the difference, kind of in your world, of what tech integration was that you were doing, and then now that you're moving towards blended learning and you're on that path, what your understanding of that is and what that looks like?
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm still learning it myself, but that my definition is evolving as I've come along on this journey, because I wasn't 100% clear when I committed to this as the vision of the school. But what we were doing was they would be using the technology in the classroom to support the instruction. So it might mean that they did a project using the iPad, maybe created a PowerPoint presentation in the computer lab, things like that, where the technology was used within a classroom setting such as math or language arts to show their understanding. But what blended learning seeks to do is to provide a way for us to personalize the learning for the students through small group instruction and meeting the students where they're at. And how we do that is with that adaptive curriculum component that we were really missing. And so with the technology, most of our technology is used for where the students get to work in math and language arts at their level. We use a variety of softwares to support that. And then the data is then used to enhance the instruction in the small group. So the teacher is allowed to really know what areas to hit with the different students. And they can constantly change the groups very quickly in order to meet the student needs.
That's fantastic. And you guys, I know, piloted this last year in your middle school, and then rolling it out this year fully to kind of the whole, all of the teachers in the whole school.
Correct. Yeah. So we started last year in our grades 5 through 8, because that was the area of need. As we've grown, we've been able to reduce the number of combo classes, but we had at that last year, at the beginning of the year, we had 2 full-time teachers and then an academic coach that was there to help support, and he was only part-time. And so we really needed to find a way in that classroom to be able to serve the needs of all of our students when during a math period, you might have 2 classes. And so how do you already have different needs for in just one grade level, let alone putting 2 grade levels in it. So what are you going to do with the students? You can't just give them busy work. It needs to be productive and you need to use your time very wisely. And so we targeted specifically, we couldn't send all of our teachers to the blended, like to get blended learning training. So we targeted that middle school that really, really needed it at the time, and sent them to a week-long training. We came back and we were working with people from LMU who were coming out to help support those middle school teachers. And it was just about finding ways to best serve the needs of our students. And then with the Diocese of San Diego, who helps us a lot, they helped us secure some funding to be able to do it K-8 this year. And it's really exciting just to have watched it grow over this last year and see it, especially in the lower grades, because we started to see what it looked like in the middle grades, but to see it in the lower grades, it's been really fun. And, you know, we're not 100% there yet. We're slowly moving towards it, but I think that's what it's about, is we can't be afraid to start. We just have to start moving in that direction and be ready to pivot.
So Amanda, you were talking about like taking these baby steps. So can you tell us, like in the very beginning, did you work with the university first and try to lay out a plan, a groundwork? Like first 6 months, we're going to try to do this, and the next semester, then we'll bring this program in, or how? What was the process?
I mostly, the beginning stages, I worked with Matthew Cordes, who's the associate director in the Office for Schools at the Diocese of San Diego. Him and I worked a lot together on what we could do to serve the needs of the students in year one. And at first we were thinking it's going to be really hard, or I was thinking it was going to be hard. And we were so lucky to get a donation in, and then that was able to start funding the dream. And so then we were able to dream a little bit bigger and start really laying that out. And he set me into contact with some people who helped us start the planning process. I'd like to say it was really rigid. We just had kind of an overall goal, is that, you know, in the first few years, it would look like this. And, you know, and then we would keep expanding upon it. But like teachers know in their classroom, it doesn't really stay to that. You have to be ready to change and adjust to the needs of the people in the room. And our teachers are basically the students at this point. And so the professional learning has been more about serving the needs of the teachers and pushing them from their point A to their point B. And so, yeah, I guess we have an overarching theme, but our overarching vision, but how we get there has changed a bit over the last couple of years.
And you guys are part of a cohort in San Diego of schools called the Next Gen Schools Project. So you and another school, St. Catherine Drexel, are kind of a part of the first half of the cohort, I think, going through a 3-year initiative. And then there's two other schools, and hopefully more funding comes in. Any donors out there that want to make a donation to these schools, that would be very, very welcome. But it's not just blended learning, right? You guys also have kind of another complementary initiative as well to kind of make this a little bit of a slower process for you guys. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. When we first initially started with blended learning last school year, we were the only school at the time in the diocese going through it, at least with partnerships and professional development kind of behind it. And then the diocese did form the Next Generation cohort. And so that was really exciting because it gave my teachers other people to work with. And that has even evolved over time. And so in addition to blended learning, the other main component is we're focusing in the sciences and really just focusing on trying to get the students to be able to show us their understanding and apply it, science in the real world. And so that's been really neat. We've been working with professionals in that area. All four schools have adapted. I should back up and say that there's two schools going through blended learning, but there's four schools going through the science component. And so the four schools going through the science are all using the same program that with the science, with the new science standards, it's really teacher friendly and allows teachers to raise their capacity with the new science standards, which has been tricky. I think that most teachers can agree that when you first look at those, they get daunting. And then the more you look into them, the more confused you become. And so to have the support behind it, with professionals leading us through the way and helping us see what good science instruction looks like and how we can make it exciting and more hands-on for our students has been really positive. I love going across all the classrooms. We're lucky since there's K-8, I get to see the big range and just to see the difference. Usually when we go into classrooms now and I ask what their favorite subject area is, they'll say science. And if I would have done that last year, we wouldn't have gotten the same response. And so it's been a really neat transformation. And so I think what we're setting out to do here is just try and really think about what's best for the students and what they're going to need in the future and in the real world, and just try to give them the best education we can. And so that's really how that all came to be.
And the four schools going through science are St. Mary Escondido, St. Catherine Drexel Academy, St. Rita's, and St. Michael's Academy. Correct. San Diego. So those are the four schools in San Diego that are part of that Next Gen cohort. I thought we should name them. And then the science curriculum that you're using is STEM scopes across the board.
Yes, across the board.
And you have the support of Dr. Anita Kreide, who's a STEM expert out of Loyola Marymount University as well. So she, although is not on staff there, she is an alum and used to teach there as well. So she's your STEM expert that's kind of leading you through this initiative with the STEM stuff.
Absolutely. And she's an expert in science, but she seems to be an expert in so many other things. She's helped as a result of this, our math program has improved, which would make sense with STEM, but just the social emotional learning, anything that the students might need, she has experience in, and it's been great. And what I will say about the four schools that you mentioned and the teachers there is that we are really blessed with teachers who have really been asked to take on a lot. This is a time commitment for them. They're receiving lots of professional development with a lot of expectations and implementation, with coaches coming out to follow up and developing teacher leaders. And I think it's something that can be hard at times, but when we show up to our professional development in service days, I'm really pleased to see how open-minded the teachers have been and how much they've embraced and tried to change it all for the benefit of the students.
And the reason I love that you guys are all coming together is because you're four small schools, smallish compared to like some of the public schools in your area, where a public school might just in and of itself do professional development. Districts do professional development. But in Catholic education, we typically just, we only have, you know, if we're lucky, if we have eight or nine or maybe even more than that teachers on staff. So having four schools together or even two schools together gives you somebody to collaborate with at your grade level or at your subject area.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's great too, is because there are different considerations that we haven't considered as our staff. And then when we go there, we're learning from them and they can learn from us. And so it's really collaborative in that way. Just like it's great when new student and teachers come on staff because it brings in a new tone and a new pace and new ideas. It's the same thing when we go over to that professional development. They just, you know, everyone thinks of things a little bit differently and communities have different ways of doing things. And so we can all benefit from one another. Our schools have a lot of similarities in terms of enrollment struggles and things like that, but we're very different too. And so it's nice that while we're all doing the same thing, we can all put our own twist on it.
I was also going to ask you, Amanda, about like how you deal with funding. How is that encapsulated in the Catholic school environment?
We don't have any. Let's just kidding.
That is exactly right.
Anybody that wants to donate to the Catholic schools, that's not entirely true. I joke because you do have you do have the support of the diocese in this particular initiative. I know the diocese is writing grants on behalf of these schools, but like ultimately your schools are responsible for your own funding and kind of doing your own things outside of this particular project and even in conjunction with this particular project. So share with us what that looks like for principals.
Also, we do get Title II funding, but our schools and our diocese have other professional development that go on that we end up pooling those monies to support kind of like curriculum mapping and things like that right now is our overall vision. And so we couldn't really use that. And we're always trying to secure funding, even though the diocese has been working hard for us. You know, I have to go out there and try and put the word out that we're looking to try and raise money for laptops for the teachers or more devices, those types of things. And so really it's just trying to get our message out there, explain the need, and just try and find the money or find ways when funding isn't coming in. You know, we try to store away a little bit money from our operating budget to be able to use for things like this. It takes time that way, but really it's just asking for money from different foundations and seeing what we can do. That comes down to just really crafting your story, though, I think is really big, because if you have something to share, people get excited about and then they want to help. And so that's really been what we've targeted.
Because isn't it also true that your families don't all pay full tuition, correct?
Correct. Well, even if they do pay full tuition, it doesn't cover the cost to educate the child. So our tuition this year is $5,755, and it probably costs closer to $10,000. You know what I mean? And so we rely on efforts of fundraising within the school community. We have a gala every year, which is our auction, as well as different functions throughout the year. And so that helps, but that just kind of covers the operating expenses when we want to do things above and beyond, like we are with blended learning, with getting the technology that we needed. That's really come from the outside donors.
And you've been blessed with a couple of really generous donors. I know that you guys have, and most Catholic schools are generously blessed with people who give. And I think sometimes people don't understand the impact of the gift. You know, right. Like $1,000 or $1,500 is huge. And if you can find 10 people that can give $1,500, you just got $15,000. So like
exactly.
Those types of things are really impactful. And so, but let's talk about devices, because you've talked about that and you're not a one-to-one school.
Not entirely. No.
So tell us, because you're so blended learning, you know, I think a lot of times people think we have to have one-to-one or we have to have a device for every child, but that's not true. And so tell us kind of how the process is for you and where you're at in it with devices.
Yeah. So we started off initially, because blended learning started in grades 5 through 8, we really focused on trying to get them devices. And because there was 2 grade levels in a class, we did strive to go one-to-one, and we were able to do that, but we picked, you know, a cheaper PC laptop in order to be able to do that. And we were blessed with a donation that came in that allowed for that, but that started. And then we had some extra money thanks to small donations here and there, just like you mentioned. And we were able to get 4th graders laptops last year as well. So that way it would help bridge the gap into our middle school. Since our middle school starts in 5th grade, it would help give them one more thing they already felt comfortable with before they got there. And then we purposely made the decision that we didn't want to go one-to-one, lower than that. And so we're actually 1-to-3 with iPads. And that was made possible through donations again, but also saving money. And then thanks to the Apple deal with education now, they lowered the cost of the iPads. We were able to get more than we thought we were going to be able to. And so we're 1-to-3 in grades K-3. And if we really needed to, we could be less than that, I think, to really successfully be able to do blended learning. It's nice that we have that, but we don't always even need all those iPads in the small group rotations, because sometimes there will be 4 different stations going on. And so we have leftover iPads anyway, but it's nice to have it for when we need it, but definitely not needed. So I'd say like any amount, you can make it work. You just have to get a little bit more creative.
I think that's fantastic. And I love, you know, I kind of love the diversity. You're exposing the kids to the Apple platform, the iOS platform, and then you're also exposing them to a Windows platform, because you went with the Windows models in the middle school. And then are you charging, like, is there a tech fee or anything like that that your families pay?
We do. We have a tech fee that is part of the registration, and we take that over 6 months with their tuition. This year it was $150, and that helps to offset the cost of the software, because the software gets to be a little pricey when you start to add it up in all the different areas. Because we personally own the devices and we let the students just use them, and it helps if something were to happen for us to be able to replace. But really, that money is dedicated more towards the software.
And then how do you, as a school, and maybe you do this with the university that you work with,
Loyola Marymount University,
decide what the funds are going to be used towards? How is that mapped out? Who or what devices or what software?
So it's kind of a combination of things. Cost is always something that we have to consider. You know, we want to be mindful of making sure we're getting the most bang for our buck, to say, but it's kind of, to be honest, because everything has come quickly in a good way, we've had to just kind of triage and do whatever needs to happen first and just try and plan, like, okay, when we have enough money, this is what's next. You know, we just got our teachers just got laptops this week. They were working on like Windows 7, really old PC computers, and not complaining about it, but we had to get, it was some of the software that the students were using on their devices weren't really even working on the teacher devices. And so that just happened. And so we have to think, well, what is next? The next thing we want to do is but we don't need it, but we're hoping to be able to put some Apple TVs on the projectors, so that way they can use their laptops with their smart boards and things like that. And so it's just about thinking about what we'd like to do. Another big thing for me would be, we're trying to save up money to get some iPads up in the middle school, because the laptops are great, but iPads can show understanding in a different ways. And as we move forward with more project-based learning, we want to be able to allow them to show things in different ways. And, you know, the iPad has some really great apps that allow students to show understanding in really cool, fun ways, right? We want to keep the students engaged and excited and having fun, but they don't even realize that they're learning.
And what's been your teacher's point of view as far as the blended learning and their experience with that so far?
You know, I think they've been really positive, and I can speak for Drexel as well and say that they really like it too. You know, obviously, when you're making a change, especially for our teachers who have been doing this for a while, it can be a little scary at first. But I think we're getting into teaching not because we want to bore the kids to death every day, but because we want them to be excited about learning. And this model has allowed for there to be a really high engagement with our students. And so I think when the students are having fun, it helps the teacher have more fun and things like that. And so it's this big circle that just keeps going. My staff has really embraced it. It's not to say that there weren't times of stress or uncertainty, but they've really taken it with stride and have run with it. And so I'm really, really proud of them, actually, because I know how hard moving in that change has been. And just for them to come in every day and just with a smile on their face and just keep pushing at it, I've been really blown away, actually, by how quickly they've pivoted and transitioned into this model.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, I'm excited too. I'm excited to hear about the software that you guys are using, because I know there's different softwares out there that are adaptive and assignable, and you have chosen some very specific softwares, and that was after a few, you've had trials, and last year there was software, and this year might be a little bit different software. And so will you tell us about that journey? Because I think this is important for administrators and teachers to hear, is how this journey went, how you got teacher input on what you were doing, and how you, your university partner, I might have had a little bit of input on this. So I just kind of want to hear what that was like for you as far as software selection. And you can go ahead and name names.
Yeah, my teachers, especially when we were just moving into this, they had no idea about any of the software. So they kind of left it up to me to decide, and I didn't know anything about it. And so, you know, I did the best I could researching online, but really I relied upon Shannon and the LMU Ideal Institute to say, you've seen this in the classrooms. Like, what are the teachers that you work with excited about? What are they saying has been helping them move forward in the blended learning model? And then using that as our jump off point, right? We don't want to recreate the wheel and have to try and go through the same steps these other schools that are maybe a little further along than us have. What I will say is there isn't a right one size. And so it really depends on the needs of your school, your budget constraints, and those types of things, because we've had great success with Khan Academy, which is free, but with some of the paid versions, as we've been able to secure more funding or use more of our budget to be able to do that, have been a little bit better in terms of being able to keep the data straight. And so what we're currently using this year is we're in K-8, we're using the same program, and it's Lexia. In K-5, they're using Core 5. We do have some students in fifth grade and in fourth grade that are already placed out of that, which is really exciting, but that's where most of our students are working. And then they have something called the Power Up strategy or Power Up, and that's what we're using in 6th through 8th. And so it just depends on the needs of the students, but it all kind of delivers similar content, just looks a little different, and one's a little bit more, you know, like a higher level. And so that's been really great. We used that last year as well in grades 5 through 8. So we've really enjoyed that program. In math, we have 3 that we're using based off of the grade levels. And that was intentional. We didn't 100% know which one we wanted to use, and we wanted to try out a couple of different ones. And then in listening to what I was hearing, we made decisions based off of the grade levels to best suit the needs. In K and 1, we're using ST Math, and I'm in love with it. I think it's so great, and what it's doing for our students, not even just in math, but in terms of having to think for themselves and just maybe not know what's being asked of them, but to try, I think is going to reap benefits beyond just the math realm. And so just the problem solving that I'm seeing in those lower grades and those abilities to not think, well, what's the right answer or what's this? Oh, I'm going to give it a try until I figure it out has been really beneficial. Not to mention, they think they're just having so much fun and they don't realize all the math that they're doing and what they're able to do. I actually have a kindergartner. In one of the games, it took me longer to figure out what was being asked than for him to do it, because he wasn't afraid to just try it. And so I think we want to make sure that we instill that within our kids. In grades 2nd through 4th grade, we're using Imagine Math. And that's been pretty neat too. We're still trying to navigate that one a little bit more. The lessons are a little bit longer. And so while we love it, we were looking for something to kind of supplement with it in terms of the for blended learning station rotation. It definitely does have its place there because there's it makes the kids try, and then there's different prompts along the way to help them work through their problems. And so we've been really happy with that too. And then in grades 5 through 8, we chose to keep Alex, and that's because they had used that last year, and they had the middle school was going through a lot of changes just across the board. We have a new socialized program. We have a new religion program up there that we wanted. We have more teachers up there this year. We have 4 instead of just the 2.5 we had last year. And so we wanted to make sure that we gave them something that was familiar and constant. And, you know, that program's been around for a while and has a great reputation in terms of being able to serve students and their needs. And so we like them all for different reasons. Of course, they all have their limitations in certain ways. What we're really excited about is we're going to be piloting Freckle coming up here pretty quickly. And I got to see that in action when I was visiting some blended learning schools up in LA. And I'm really excited for our teachers to use that. And our teachers are really excited, and for our students to get to be able to experience that.
I'm a big fan of Freckle. I like Alex. I love Imagine Math. A lot of our blended learning schools have used all of the programs that you mentioned. The one thing I want, ST Math is actually based out of San Diego, as I recall.
That's not Shannon Tibaldo Math.
It's not Shannon Tibaldo Math. Although I will, you know, I mean, it could be. It's not. I think it's based out of San Diego, if I'm not mistaken, and or that part of California. And it stands for Spatial Temporal Math, which is, if you've ever taught in a GATE program or the Gifted and Talented or any of those, they really focus a lot on spatial temporal learning. So that's a great program. And this, they're not endorsing us unless they want to. You can reach out to us at mytechtoolbelt.com. But I like that. I like my son actually also used ST Math, and I know it's in a couple of districts up here as well. And the cool thing about it is there's no language barrier when it comes to mathematics. So this Correct. Is great in the EL space. Mm. This is great for kids because there is no there's no auditory directions given. The little penguin kind of just does his thing, and there's no written directions. So they're really just have the opportunity to explore, and it just pushes their brains to do a lot of that. Try, fail. Oh, try something different, fail. And I was with you, Amanda, when my son was doing this in school. I was like, I don't understand what you're supposed to be doing here. I don't understand. The flower petals are moving around. And he's just like, oh, you're just like this. Boom, put all 10 flower petals together. And then it makes a flower. And I was like, all right, I don't know what's happening here. But I know the penguin's moving across, and he's leveling up, and he's going across. And he, so it was pretty cool. That was when he was in third grade. And so it's a great product. And I do like them. All of those softwares, you have a lot. And I think you'll be kind of really finding the 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 that fit the needs of your school population. I think that's one thing that teachers and administrators maybe don't understand when they're first starting this journey is you kind of, maybe you thought this too, I don't know, is that we're going to find an ELA software, we're going to find a science mm-hmm. software, and we're going to find a math software, and we're going to be good to go. And I know when we had conversations, you and I had conversations, I was like, well, it's not that simple. and it's not because what your school is using is not necessarily the same thing that St. Catherine Drexel Academy is using. And because it may not fit the needs of those students. So, and blended learning schools across the country are using different products too. And the main thing that they're looking for is the growth, the student growth.
Absolutely. And I also think there's temptation as an administrator to think, well, we should adopt, if we're adopting Lexia, it should be K-8 like we did. We did that because we chose to, not because we felt like it had to. I know I fell in that box even at the beginning. It's really about picking. It might mean that like with what we did with math, there are different ones for the different grade levels. I wouldn't recommend going like bouncing back and forth between like kindergarten is ST Math, first grade something different than ST Math comes back in. That can get confusing for the students. But if you're really deliberate it might mean that different grade level bands have different needs as well. And so you transition from one to the next, and so forth. And so I think that as an administrator, I think that's an important thing to really consider is that it might even vary on your school site a little bit. And so to be open to having differences across the grade levels.
And it keeps them from getting bored. I mean,
that's true.
I mean, I'm thinking from a kid's perspective because I'm not that far away from being a kid, but like, if you do the same thing
right for 9 years,
for nine that's a years, long time. Like, and it's the same program, and it might evolve over time, but like,
yeah, it's the same thing.
It's the same thing. So what you're doing is you're mixing it up. You're giving them a few years. They're getting excited about it, and then boom, we're going to go try something else, and they're going to learn different strategies and different techniques. And Imagine Math has, you know, built-in homework help and online tutorials, and you know, all kinds of really great things. They have super cool, like, competitions coming up. Well, actually, like, right now, their March Madness type thing is getting ready to get started. And anyways, the schools compete, and however many, like, lessons they can win prizes and pizza parties and all kinds of cool stuff and trophies. And
it's a real deal because I visited a school that won last year. And so it's not like one of those things that you hear about and you wonder if anything ever materializes. It does. And it was really cool to see and hear from that administrator's perspective, how just uplifting that was for their students. You know, like, they love the competitive aspect. They're all really neat and different. And I think, you know, I think also it's really important that just because something's working really well at your school, you have to keep your ears open because so many different things are popping up and you have to be ready to explore those new things just because there might be something better that works better for your students. You know what I mean? And so, right. You know, you fall in love with something and you stay committed to it. And I think that's great, but you also have to be ready to part if there's when something comes in that's a little bit better. Just like as education turns, we have to be ready to adjust the way we teach and the way the students learn and things like that. We have to be ready. We have to be looking at those things because if you're not, you know, everything will move on without you. Mm-hmm. And that won't be what's best for your students.
Great point.
I was thinking about your teachers. So Brenda earlier asked, you know, kind of about how your teachers have adapted to this, and you said really well, but you can't do this alone. You really have had to kind of cultivate a culture in your school of teacher leadership and yes. growth mindset, and like, we're all in this together. What does that look like for you and your teachers, and how have you kind of cultivated partnerships and relationships with those teacher leaders?
Yeah, it's been a blessing, actually. Catholic schools, you know, don't necessarily have the same type of administration levels that you would see in a public school or maybe a really big Catholic school or private school. And so at my school site, this isn't true of all, but I'll speak for my school site. It's just me. There's no official vice principal. We have a teacher in charge for when I'm not there, but it's just me. And I have 9 teachers that are going through this right now, and I'm trying to support all of them, but I can't do all of that and my job, and I'm not in the thick of it with them. So I don't exactly know what it means to be a blended learning teacher because I was never in that situation. And so it was about that dispersed leadership model and finding teachers to help support our teachers on our site. And I think it's been so, so great to see these teachers come through and just show us their leadership and just to have different perspectives. And so at our school site currently, and I only anticipate this growing, and everyone at our school in some way or another has leadership in one way or another, but I'm just going to talk about it in the realm of kind of the next generation schools. I have a teacher leader in science. And so she's starting her second year with that. And she's our 4th grade teacher. She did teach science in middle school for 1 year, and she's taught kindergarten. And so she was a really great fit in understanding the idea of finding somebody who kind of gets the whole picture, because that can be hard when you're serving students in grades K-8. And so she spent a year being coached by Anita, and then Anita has kind of helped prepare her to go and coach other teachers as well. And so she started coaching another teacher on our site. She started with our kindergarten teacher, and she's about to take on a second teacher, but that's just like official coming into the classroom and observing. She's always already there helping all of our teachers with whatever questions that they might have. And then I also have a tech TOSA, and his, he's our middle school social studies teacher. And his job is to help teachers understand how they can use different apps or different websites to help enhance instruction. So it might be, hey, let's take a look at Kahoot, or this is how you use Flipgrid. And so that's been really neat to get people away from just using it solely for like word processing and, you know, maybe a PowerPoint and maybe the adaptive curriculum. And so we're beginning to start to bring some of those things in. And so that's kind of his role on campus, is to kind of help highlight some of these different technological tools and how we can use them. And so that's crucial, because I think people are afraid to start, but when they start to see it and they realize there's somebody there with them, it's really helpful. And so that's been great. And then I also, we have another teacher on campus. This is a little out of the NGS, but he's working in math as kind of, he's our math site leader, and he's going to move into that math coaching to help support our teachers in math, since that's so integrated with everything that we're doing. And we're in the middle of really looking at our math program.
And that has been, I think you hit the nail on the head. It's like, it's crucial as an administrator to understand and let go of some of these things and really kind of, I won't say offload them, but let your teachers lead so that you're not doing it all, because you can't do it all. And as soon as an administrator realizes that, it's like an epiphany, right? Did it feel like a load kind of off your shoulders of like...
It definitely does. I think it's this battle, and I still go through it. You want to make sure your teachers feel supported and that they understand that you're in the throes with them, and that you're here to help them, and that you get it, and that you're ready in any way, shape, or form. And so that's the part that's hard to give up, because you don't want them to think that it's just like, I'm just sitting back in my office, you know what I mean? Like, while you guys do everything. But I think it's just so valuable. I think that giving people a chance to shine in their areas of expertise and building leaders, that's what we're doing with our students. We need to start modeling it with our staff. We need to, like, if we're saying everyone can be a leader, we should be showing that across our staff. They shouldn't say that a school shouldn't rely only upon one person as the leader. And it doesn't matter how big, if I were ever to be at like a really big school, I would really look towards making like the teacher leader model a priority, just because not only that, it's given these teachers who have been doing things for a while a sense, like a new sense of purpose and ownership. And I think there's a lot to say about that too, is that you get these people pumped and on fire about whatever their respective thing is, whether it be science or technology or math. And then that's contagious to our teachers. And I think it just builds capacity across all levels. And so it's really rewarding, and not just letting things off my plate, but allowing my teachers their chance to shine, as well as do what's best for the students. Because if I was the one coaching them, they would not be getting the best answer, because I'm not doing it every day. Like, I have the theory behind it. I have what I've seen, which can be valuable because I get to go into classrooms quite often, but it's not the same as somebody who's in there doing it.
All right. Exactly. Great points.
I know.
So what does your professional development look like for your school? Do you have weekly meetings, or is it twice a year on the weekend? And
so my staff as a whole, we meet in some capacity nearly every week, pretty exclusively, unless there's a conflict, like maybe in no school or something that day. But in terms of our professional development plan and working with Loyola Marymount University and Anita, that is, we pretty much have a monthly professional development. We meet once a month on Wednesdays, and it's typically like they meet for a half day. And so that's been great, because that's that opportunity for those teachers to collaborate. And so we've made it a priority. There's other things that we're doing within the NGS that are maybe our full days. So we're also doing graduate profiles, which is a whole nother thing, really exciting. But those are like 4 one-day sessions. I feel like we're kind of always kind of in professional development in some way or shape or form, because I walk into the staff lounge and I'm hearing them talk about what's going on in their classrooms and brainstorming with each other. But officially with our PD providers, it's about once per month. And then we also, another time per month, we're doing like professional learning communities as for school sites led by our providers as well.
And that's done virtually. So that's new.
Oh, I like that.
That's kind of a new model because...
And it's getting these four schools?
These four schools come together via Zoom. So every teacher joins a Zoom link. And then the PLC is led. And then we use Zoom to do breakout rooms. And I mean, it's a pretty new-ish model for I know the university and but it seems to be working out really well. The teachers like it. They don't have to drive. San Diego is a very spread out diocese. Right. And so it gives them an opportunity to kind of stay in their classrooms, or if they have time to get home before the PLC starts, they can join wherever they are. And then their breakouts are either, depending on what the topic is, usually by grade level or subject area. Am I right, Amanda?
Yeah. And we're already traveling once per month. And our school is one that travels typically because we are the furthest north. Everyone else is pretty close to one another. So we travel and it takes us like 40 minutes to an hour just to get to the school site. And so my teachers actually prefer the virtual realm because they're in their space. They don't have to rush to get there and then be prepared to talk and what's it called. They just get to relax, hop on about 20 or 30 minutes after school gets out. And then, you know, have these really interesting conversations. And then I think it also opens up a space for them to think, hey, we can do this kind of on our own. While it might not be through Zoom, it might be through email or text messages and things like that. And so that's really what we're trying to do, is create these relationships with the teachers that it doesn't have to only be during that time. They can connect outside as well.
Pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
So I know I'm super excited about the work that you're doing. I know Brenda has a couple questions that she likes to ask everybody.
Yes. Don't be too afraid.
I should remember what these are.
Because she is an avid listener to our podcast.
You're one of our, I think, first subscribers, I think.
Yeah.
Probably. I was waiting. When's it going to come out?
When are you going to ask me the question?
So I always like to ask people if you have any books that have made an impact on you, either professionally or personally, that you'd like to share with us.
Oh, there's a lot. A big one for me right out of the gate was Good to Great. Really thinking about that idea that you can't be fixed. I know I mentioned it earlier in the terms of software, but being ready to move on to the next thing. And if you're not evolving, you can kind of get left behind. I just got a new book that I am really excited about that I haven't started reading yet, but it was given to us by the Office for Schools, and it's Design Thinking for School Leaders. And so we've been working on the design thinking process, but I like that it's about, it's in the school realm. And so I'm really excited about that, and it came well recommended. And then what I've most recently been pumped on, and I'm getting my teachers pumped on, is edu protocols. And so I'm really excited to see how we can start to incorporate some of that. And I learned about that through your podcast, actually. The podcast is what got me pumped, and listening to John, I became a super fan overnight, and I, you know, instantly ordered the book. I think it was, you guys had that little conversation with him at Q, and he mentioned that it was coming. So I ordered it and I started reading it. And so I'm really excited to see how we can incorporate that into our station rotation model with blended learning.
It's so magical. I can't even tell you. We're obviously big fans. Those are great. Those are all great books. Mm-hmm. Fantastic books.
Great recommendations. Have you ever had a tech failure that you'd like to share with us, where technology did not work out as well as you were planning on it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we have those types of things all the time. I'm trying to quickly think about something I can recall as of recent. I know that one year I decided, you know, we're upping the game and we're going to go super techie to show our parents this. I'm going to have everyone sign into this parent meeting using Google Docs. And
smart.
The first problem was that the Wi-Fi, the first problem was, is that our pop-up blocker was blocking it on our iPad. Right. And so I figured a workaround around that because I am tech and I couldn't get on to the pop-up blocker to get out of it. I don't have an IT department. And so I figured out a workaround. But then when I moved them into the room we were having, the Wi-Fi wouldn't connect. I was so prepared with like QR codes so parents could use their phone if they wanted. And so it just became this big thing. And so I had to go back to the pen and paper, trying to move everything. So that was funny because the whole meeting was about how we were moving in to tech and like all the improvements we had made with like the tech integration and then and how like our infrastructure would support all of that. And then our Wi-Fi is just not in this one room because we don't really use it. And I was like, well, that's something for me to consider next time.
Typical.
So that's probably the biggest
one. I like that one. That's perfect.
But you know.
Life happens.
Been there, done that. That's for sure.
I think that's good though. I mean, it's good that you were able to be like, oh, okay, analog today.
That's right. And moving on.
You know, and if you let it frazzle you, it could really just like that could have gone horribly wrong if you were frazzled. But you just kept pivoting, and then you're we'll just keep going.
And we have an awesome parent community at St. Mary, and so they just laughed along with us and. They actually like it when we do like pen and paper stuff like that. So they were probably, some of them were probably a little bit relieved. Right. And then the ones who didn't could use the QR code from their phone.
Yeah. And it was fine. I always say it's not a tech presentation if the tech doesn't have some kind of a glitch.
That's right.
You know, I mean, even just last week at the Kulapalooza, the QLA event, it was, you know, there's always those little glitches you get. Mm-hmm. Oh, we had to switch rooms because that one didn't have any hookups. And you're like, of course it didn't.
Right.
It's just, you know, it isn't a tech conference or a tech event. If you don't have some kind of glitch. No, that's a great story. Thanks for sharing that with us. What advice, I was going to ask a not as fun question as Brenda's. I was just going to say, what advice do you have for new principals? I know you're still a relatively new principal. You're still in kind of year three. But what would you say to a principal who's like, you know, it's January of their year one and – you know, thinking back to where you were in January of your year one, what kind of advice would you give them? And it doesn't have to be tech related. It's just what advice would you give kind of a new principal as they're navigating these waters?
You know, I just met with the guy I work with Apple. His name's Kevin. And he so eloquently put it, and I'm trying to think of the exact wording. I have always said it, but I couldn't get it quite as clear as he did. And he said, if you really want something to be able to work, you have to believe in it. And I was so hung up in year one about how is the funding going to come, or how is this going to look, or how am I going to get this together? How can I make this happen? That it was inhibiting me from getting the ball rolling and starting. And so I would say that set the dream and then just work towards it. And it might mean baby steps along the way.
Right. Yeah. No, good point.
That's great.
I love it. Because, Kevin. Sometimes the hardest part is that first step.
Yeah. Kevin's going to be so glad he got a shout out on this podcast because I know he listens to it too.
You know, you don't want to just make decisions to make decisions, but once you've kind of set your mind to something, start working towards it. And it's okay if you can't do it all at once. So just start moving towards it. And I think that's been where I've seen our greatest success. And so once I kind of got out of my own way, we were really able to start moving the school forward.
I want to piggyback on that too, is some of the things that like I love about what you did. And I think what your next gen schools does was they had the mindset like you of, I'm not going to reinvent the wheel. I need to go find somebody else that's done this, or I need to partner with someone. And there are people out there that have done whatever it is you're looking to do. And if there's not, you need to find somebody willing to like take that leap with you, because you could probably write a grant and get a lot of money for whatever it is. And I think that, you know, you partnering with the universities, you partnering with the Loyola Marymount team, they've done this before. They've got a track record in the Bay Area and in the LA area, and they've partnered with other people who have done this too. So it's pretty cool that you know, you kind of sought out people to bounce ideas off of and say, hey, I don't want to reinvent the wheel. I need to find somebody else who kind of can help me. And not that, you know, was the only way to go, but I think it was a good decision just to know you're not alone. You do have somebody to text or call.
I think not being afraid to ask questions has been huge. I never have felt like I was dumb or not equipped to be a principal based off of the questions that I've asked. Every time I've ever asked, people have been very helpful. And so I think you can't be afraid just to put it out there, because you're not going to be able to grow yourself or your school without getting the answers that you need. And, you know, you have to, you know, at the end of the day, you're the person that makes the decision. So you just take in all that information and then you decide what's best for your school, because at the end of the day, you know the school better than anyone else, mm-hmm. or you and your staff and your parents. It's kind of a collaboration there. But and then just being ready and willing to take a leap and making sure that you craft your message. I think that's something that people kind of forget about, especially for me. I ended up in the role a little bit last minute. I was called in at the end of July and asked to take over as principal. I had already signed the contract for third grade. So to have to kind of then, I didn't really have time to even wrap my brain around it. It was, let's get in there. Let's try and get everything in right functional order, like operationally. And so I think it's easy to say, oh, I can do that later, but really understanding your school, understanding what your school needs are and where you need to go, and then crafting that message and putting it out there is really helpful in being able to go out and get those donations and find more answers, find people that are doing similar things as you to relate with and collaborate with and learn from. And so that's something that I think sometimes people overlook, and it should be like number one on that mm-hmm. priority of like the vision and why behind it.
Finding your why. Mm-hmm. That's a Simon Sinek. Do it. Just find your why. Know your story. You know, it doesn't have to be like, you don't have to write a book or anything about it. You got to know who your school are, who you're serving, and why you're doing what you're doing. And when you tell that story, it's authentic.
Well, we really appreciate all your time today, Amanda. I think you're so inspirational as an administrator, and I think you're going to inspire other principals to perhaps want to contact you. So what is the best way to have them contact you?
The best way to contact me would be via email. I'm also on social media. It's A Johnston, so AJOHNSTON at STMESC.org. I am also on Twitter, and you can find me at SMS Mrs. Johnston. And our school one, if you're interested in what's going on at our school, would be at St. Mary Escondido, St. Mary Escondido. And that's the same handle for our Instagram as well. And so that has a little bit more of the pictures and whatnot. And so it's always really exciting. I love connecting with people who have similar ideas or even different ideas. I think there's a lot to be learned there. And just connecting with people has been really important in my growth as an educator and an administrator. And so I love to continue that.
So, Amanda, this is not your first podcast. You're a podcast guest veteran. You've been on another podcast before. And so we want to give them a plug because they're friends. So go ahead. What was the podcast you were on?
Absolutely. I wouldn't call myself a veteran. I've only been on one other podcast. But
that's a veteran.
That podcast was SMA Audio Experience. And what's really neat about that podcast is it's a podcast for a Catholic school in my diocese here in San Diego County. And it's run by a parent that does the tech there who is also an alumni of the school. And it's just his passion for the school and getting the word out there about what they're doing, as well as learning from other Catholic schools or any schools in general, just about what's best practices in education.
Awesome.
Super cool. You are episode 20 on his podcast. I was just looking that up from February of 2018. So if you want to listen to Amanda on the SMA Audio Experience, episode 20 is her episode. Well, I just want to thank you for your time today. You've helped our listeners. This is kind of one of the first episodes on blended learning that we've done. And we've taken the lens from a principal's perspective, kind of new to the role. So thank you for being so so open and honest with us about this experience. It's been really fun.
Yes. Well, thank you so much for your time. It's been great getting to know you better, Amanda.
Thank you so much for having me. I just want to say that I really do love your podcast. And I think that it's really neat to be able to listen and hear, learn about a new tech tool and how a teacher uses it and then the resources that you provide. It's really fun to listen to. And so I always, when I find different ones, I'll like send them to different teachers to be like, hey, this seems like it'd be a really great tool for you. And then I feel like they've become listeners as a result, just because you guys are really engaging.
Aww, we appreciate
thank
that.
You, Amanda, our biggest fan.
Our biggest fan. I remember.
I want to take that title. Number one.
I think you can be the president of our fan club.
Absolutely.
I'll never forget. An episode that you called me and you said, if you haven't booked.
Oh, the principal. Yeah, yeah, the principal.
You listened to the.
Yeah, the superintendent. You listened to Peter Piccone's episode on Kahoot. And you, I think the next time I saw you, or via email or via text message, you said, if you haven't booked this superintendent yet. And I was like, we're working on it. But so if the superintendent's listening.
Yes, please.
I think my email went to spam, but I'm going to reach out to you again. We're trying again. Thank you so much, Amanda. We appreciate your time, and I look forward to learning more about your school over the next few years. Hopefully you'll check in with us again as you guys are kind of at the tail end of this process and see where you guys are at.
Yeah, and it'll definitely evolve as we start to understand it a little bit more too, because we're also new to it. So I'm excited to see where it takes us over the next few years and beyond.
That'll be a great way to catch up.
Yeah. Follow-up episodes.
Yep, absolutely.
All right. Well, thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Take care.
Bye.
And
we're out.
Thanks for listening to the MyTech Toolbelt podcast. If you have enjoyed listening, please rate us on Apple Podcasts or send us some feedback on our website, mytechtoolbelt.com. We would love to hear from you. This will help us deliver the content that you want to hear. Thanks, and we're out.